We come here this afternoon to celebrate the life of Dr. Joe Rawlings. Probably every one of you are here today because he could have been your doctor, or he was your friend, or you worked for him, you fished with him, you were a member of the Old Clockney Social Club, just a lot of different places. But I heard somebody once say that friends are like stars. They come out in the darkest moments of your life. This might be a darkest moment for us today. But as the evangelist D.L. Moody once said, you're going to read in the paper where D.L. Moody has died and passed away. But you can rest assured that I will be more alive than I've ever been before. Joe Rawlings is more alive today than he's ever been before. We miss him, but the choice is ours to whether we see him again. Because after spending time with him, like a lot of you have, I know I have no reservations about where Joe's at today. I mean, he lived that kind of life. The Bible says that a friend loves at all times and a brother is born for adversity. A lot of us in this room have experienced adversity when Joe came to our rescue, sickness, illness, whatever it might have been. But then the Bible also says that a man that has friends must first be a friend, and there's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Friends, we need them. We love them, and we're thankful that we have them. At times like this, we often go to God's Word just looking for something that can make us feel better, something that can give us hope. I had the privilege of sitting with Blake and Joe and Robbie a few weeks ago on a Sunday afternoon, and we talked about spiritual things, and I asked Joe, and if you know his history about when he was growing up and the things that he was involved in. There was even a time when Joe felt like he might be being called to the ministry. But he was very active as a young man in his church and later on when he was in school. But looking for something that will comfort us today, and these are scriptures that you've all heard before. In John chapter 14, Jesus says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would tell you so. But I go and prepare a place. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again to receive you, that where I am, you may be also." I put my faith and trust in that verse right there. There's three things in there. There's a promise, a place, and a way to get there. I don't know whether you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, but I would pray that you do. And if you don't, you realize how fragile that life is. Every one of us has got an expiration date on us, and only God knows when that is. So I would pray and hope that just like Joe did one time, that you'll make a decision and get all of that squared away in your life. Over in John chapter 11, verse 25, we read these words from Jesus. "I'm the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall not die." We have the promise of God's word about what the future holds for us that believe. For a believer to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And I firmly believe that Joe was a believer, and I believe that he's sitting at the feet of Jesus today, and he's feeling no pain, nothing. He might be concerned about some of us in here because he's seen what it's like. And it's the song that we'll hear in a few minutes says, I can only imagine what it must be like that. But anyway, just think about Joe, and in the coming weeks and months and years ahead, these folks sitting up here, share with them. Every one of you have got a story about something that he did. You know, he was the guy, Robbie could send him to the grocery store for a quart of milk, and it'd take him 3 hours. because somebody, he found somebody to talk to and visit with, or somebody would come to him with an ailment, and he because he was Joe, he never said no to anybody. But at this time, Lee's going to come and share some words about his dad.
Y'all want to come up? Good afternoon. My name is Lee Rawlings, and we're standing up here as Joe Rawlings' five sons, Jeff, Steve, Blake, and Tyler. It's a humbling privilege to be standing before all of you. Looking at all the faces, I'm acutely aware that anything I share will be woefully inadequate to communicate what we all feel about a man's life that meant so much to so many. But he was a special man, doctor, father, grandfather, and husband. So I'll do my best to honor him with some words of remembrance and encouragement. Where did my dad come from? He grew up in Dixon, Tennessee, near Nashville. His parents were not wealthy. I'm not going to sing the rest. His parents were not wealthy by any stretch. He was very close with his sisters, Jeanette and Elise. His baptism in Yellow Creek, practical jokes, and life in a rural small town with uncommonly wise parents of exemplary character were stories that he loved to tell and retell. A favorite of his was the time he, around 10 years old, was woken by his mother with the news that a family down the road had lost their house to a fire, and the instruction to go to his closet and pick some clothes for the boy who was about his size. "And they better be your best clothes," his mother said. By that evening, the family had a roof over their heads, appliances, food, and clothes, all orchestrated by his mother. It might have been considered strange by some that a white family would do that for a black family in the 1940s, but that was the kind of thing that made Joe Rawlings our beloved beau. My dad was never bothered with finding the right time to call someone, a trait that I'm sure he exercised on many of you, but he enjoyed hearing the voice of his dear sister, Elise, perhaps the most. She, along with her husband Larry, has been a constant, supporting, guiding, and cherishing presence for his entire life. Even though she once threw a croquet ball at him, she was a tender mercy to his heart. Dad grew up in a different era when things were a little simpler. His paper route through winters in Middle Tennessee really was trudging through snow, ice, wind, and rain. And he learned a lot on that route, along with all the other little jobs that required him to wake up early and go to bed late. My dad was taught to work hard, be responsible, and care deeply, and he was proud to call Tennessee his home. What was my dad's life about? I'll start with a couple interesting facts about my dad that you may or may not know. He loved poetry and made us all memorize the poem Jabberwocky at 5 years old. He tried but never discovered a maximum appropriate number of flashlights, knives, or fishing rod and reels to own. Jumper boxes, especially if on sale, were always fair game when shopping. He loved to quote the species and genus of his favorite fish, the black crappie, Pomoxus nigromaculatus. He was contemplative, often interested in deep ideas about life and difficult questions. He was an uncommonly gifted storyteller, possessing a unique and infectious pace and tone. Never one to be rushed, he would take his time and say it the way he wanted. As stated before, Dad would never hesitate to call, introduce himself to strangers, or stop and talk. He was intent on knowing people and their story, but often he just wanted to hear the sound of your voice. He never complained, even when he had all the reason in the world for it. His cardiologist can attest to that. People absolutely loved to reminisce about and with him. His daughter-in-law's nameplate had to be removed because the last name Rawlings resulted in a very long line at the bank. My dad, as Jimmy stated, seriously considered entering the ministry and ultimately decided on medicine. He sometimes wondered if he made the right choice. Our dad was special. The phrase is perhaps overused, but to say they broke the mold after him is very appropriate. He was gifted in some unique ways, and as his sons, it will be our inheritance, responsibility, and journey to discern, understand, and replicate those ways. Our dad would be the first to tell you that he was not perfect, that there were some things he would have done differently. But I'd like to talk about his most profound gift, the ability to love people. 1 Corinthians 13 is traditionally a marriage passage. If I speak in tongues of men but have not love, I'm only a resounding gong or clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and knowledge, if I have a faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. And at the end it says, and now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Joe Rawlings was able to love people, to see people just as they were, making them feel comfortable and safe, like they were the only ones in the room. He could do this with people from all walks of life and treasured all of them the same, telling them they were important to him, and it was his pleasure to be their friend. He had a remarkable ability of putting people at ease. His countenance was warm, disarming, and welcoming. People often wanted to be his friend as soon as they met him, because of his way with them. The story of the Good Samaritan, of loving your neighbor, is so powerful and transcendent because the Samaritan had no reason to love the stricken man. Multiple people crossed him on a busy road, but crossing cultural and socioeconomic boundaries, he saved this man by meeting and attending to his immediate needs at great personal cost to himself. And my dad was a lot like that. He would take his time, go to the house, call in the prescription, and make the referral without asking for anything in return. What has been reiterated so many times by our family over the past few days is just how much he enjoyed doing that. He enjoyed it because he loved people. If you were someone who called our house at night or showed up unannounced or met him in the driveway or parking lot, I can say without hesitation and full assurance that it was his honor and delight to take care of you. He truly cherished the opportunity and responsibility of caring for your needs. His office and practice of medicine, lived out rather than clocked in, was his ministry. So what would Dad want you to hear today? What would he want you to do? There were a couple things that he would tell us, and he would say, tell the important people in your life that you love them. If they're special, if they mean something to you, it's never too early or too late to say it. You can never know what burden someone's carrying. Compassion is wrought by perspective, genuine interest, and curiosity. Don't assume you know how hard or easy someone has it. So ask questions and learn their story. Feast together. When you gather for a meal with loved ones or friends, soak up every moment. My dad would say frequently, usually as an excuse to get some good steaks or fry fish, this isn't a meal, it's a celebration. The celebration was that we were together, and he was thankful. Take the time to recognize and be grateful for all that we've been given. My dad was blessed early in life with a combination of circumstances, gifts, and awareness that led to what he called his epiphany. As a 12-year-old, It was a moment when clarity, determination, and resolve coalesced to the firm and enduring realization that life was not coming to him. In this moment, he apprehended a purpose and responsibility for how the events of his life would unfold. And if he were here today, he would credit that epiphany and encourage us to let go of excuses and fully engage all of the gifts that God has given us. As with the parable of the talents, we are responsible to use the gifts that we've been given to the glory of God, our Creator. My dad realized his responsibility early in life, and we are thankful that he did. As the sons of Joe Rawlings, we would like to thank Robbie Rawlings, his wife, for her care and attention to his wants and needs over the years, but especially the past few months. My dad went out the way he wanted, and that was due to her tireless and sacrificial efforts. It's a testimony to the kind of love that my dad motivated in people, seeing how she strove to make sure he was comfortable, cared for, attended to, encouraged, redirected at times, facilitated, and cherished. Mom, thank you. Our brother Blake also deserves special acknowledgement as a man who dedicated the past few years to his dad. His strength and loyalty have truly been impressive to behold. From the bottom of our hearts, thank you to all of you here. We will forever be grateful to Thomasville for the way that this community has loved and cherished our dad. We are thankful to his patients and their families who trusted him with their medical problems and constantly reminded him of how much he meant to them. Dad was blessed with wonderful doctors and nurses who took compassionate care of him, especially over the last few months. Thank you to his close friends who were an abiding presence in his life, calling, taking him to dinner, receiving him for dinner, and constantly checking on him. Most of all, we are thankful to our Heavenly Father who gave us Bo Rawlings for 85 years. He was a gift and example to many. May we seek to live as he would hope and thus continue his heritage and legacy. The words of his hymn of his sisters comes to mind. It says, "So surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly lives. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe. In the lives we inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful." Lastly, with Easter yesterday, we gathered as a family and spent some time thinking about what it means that Jesus died and rose again in the context of losing our father and husband. Jesus died for our sins and rose to the glory of the Father so that we might rise with him. He weeps with us as Jesus wept outside the tomb of Lazarus. He knows our hearts, the pain and loss we feel. If the tomb really was empty and Jesus has raised my father to new life, I think he would encourage us during this time to lean on Jesus. My dad would love the story in John 21 about Jesus after being raised from the dead on the shore of the Sea of Tiberias. A story about catching a mess of fish and having a fish fry. The disciples had been fishing all night with no luck. Jesus comes to them and says, "Cast your nets on the other side." They fill the nets and only then realize it was Jesus who told them where to cast. By the time they get back with all the fish, he has breakfast ready for them. I think Jesus was asking them to obey and believe. Their obedience to listen and fish on the other side of the boat was the path to recognizing who he was. And Jesus offers us to feast on him. He beckons them to come and have breakfast. Jesus knows. He meets our needs, and we can find our comfort in him. And sometimes he does it with a fish fry. This is Bo Rawlings' 70-year-old Bible, and the bookmark was turned to Psalm 138, and I'll close with this. "I will praise thee with my whole heart before the gods will I sing praise unto thee. I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified the word above all thy name. In the day when I cried, thou answerest me and strengthenest me with strength in my soul. All the kings of the earth shall praise thee, O Lord, when they hear the words of thy mouth. Yea, they shall sing in the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. Though the Lord be high, yet hath he respect unto the lowly. But the proud he knoweth afar off. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, thou wilt revive me. Thou shalt stretch forth thine hand against the wrath of mine enemies, and thy right hand shall save me. The Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the works of thine own hands. Thank you. God bless.
Imagine.
I'm not sure, but everything that needs to be said might have already been said. But if you'll bear with me for just a few minutes, I'd like to share some things with you. When I was thinking about Joe, he came here in 1968, and I came back from veterinary school in 1969, and he was our doctor. I was married, had children. But in John chapter 13, there's a story that took place in the upper room on the night before Jesus was crucified. And he's gathered his disciples together, and they're having a meal. And when they first came into the room, it would have been customary back in those days for a servant to take a basin of water and a towel and get down on his hands and knees and wash the feet of those that came in to the house to dine, visit, whatever it might be. But on this particular occasion, as they came in, nobody was there to wash their feet. And the disciples all came in and went and sat down. And lo and behold, Jesus came in, realizing what was going on, took a towel and a basin of water, removed his clothes, got down on his hands and knees, and went around the room washing the feet of his disciples. I don't know if any of you have ever been in a foot washing service. Perhaps some of you grew up in a Pentecostal church. I don't know. But it's a very humbling experience to wash somebody else's feet, and even more so to have your own feet washed. But we're here today to talk about a man that washed a lot of feet. When I think about that verse and I think about what Jesus did, I think about, first of all, that he made himself available to do something nobody else wanted to do. And Joe Rawlings made himself available, oftentimes at the expense of his family, to meet the needs of those of us that had a need. It might have been a physical need. It might have been a spiritual need. It could have been a monetary need. I don't know. But each and every one of us has got a story in here about what Joe did for us and how he ministered to us. But the second thing is, he had the right attitude. And it's like Lee said, it was all about love. Love. Loving everybody that came in, irregardless of who you are, what color you were, what your problem was, everybody was the same. But then when he got there and the time came, he took action. He did something. He did something nobody else would do. Oftentimes, Joe was the only person that could help us with the problem, the situation that we were in. But then Jesus did something else. When he got up after washing their feet, he looked at them and said, "Do you understand what I've just done?" And they kind of looked at each other because they really didn't know. But what he had done was taught them how to serve. How to serve. My favorite verse in the Bible comes out of Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4 that says, "Let nothing be done through pride or ambition, but with all humility esteem other people more important than I am." That sums up Dr. Joe Rawlings' life. It was about other people. It was about his wife, his five boys, and about all of us. One way or the other, he ministered to us. That's the example of a servant. He modeled servanthood to each and every one of us. When I think about what Lee said about love, I think about the L stands for listen. Joe, like I said, he could go to the grocery store and you could hem him up and he'd stand there and listen to whatever your ailment or whatever your problem was. He always had time. He drove his office staff absolutely crazy, probably, because he'd get in a room and talk. If he saw you sitting in the exam room, he might put him in my office. He made everybody feel important. But he listened to everything that was said. He overlooked a lot of problems. I heard an interesting story. He had an employee years ago, a young lady, that he thought, and there was some controversy about whether she was going to work out or not in the practice. And he got concerned, and he felt like he needed to do something. But he stopped and prayed about it. And when he called her into the office, she said, I know what I'm in here for. I know, you're fixing to let me go. And Joe had prayed about it, and he sat there, and he kept thinking, what do I need to do? What do I need to do? I know maybe what I need to do, but I just don't feel right. So he looked at her, and he said, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you a raise. And on top of that, I'm going to give you a bonus. And to the day that he left that practice, my understanding is she was there. And she's probably in this room today, sitting in here. So he listened, he overlooked, but then he valued people. I heard the most interesting story from Jeff. When Jeff was a young man, he worked in his daddy's office. And one day Joe came and got him and said, come go with me. I want you to meet somebody. And he took him into an exam room. There was an elderly black man there. Very old, very old. And Joe began to tell Jeff what all this man had done, what he'd accomplished in his life, and what a great patient he'd been, and what an inspiration to me, Jeff, this man has been in my life. And I can only imagine what it must have been like for that gentleman to sit there. Probably nobody had ever maybe invested any time in him. But Joe thought enough of the man and enough of his son to take him in the room. And he taught Jeff a lesson that day. And the lesson is everybody's important. We can find good in anybody if we look hard enough. But then the E in love stands for encouragement. They told me the story of when Joe was in college at Peabody College. He got up every morning about 5 o'clock and went to the cafeteria. He was working his way through school, and he was cooking breakfast. And that particular morning, he looked up, and a young girl, came in with a cane, and she was tapping the floor. And she had on dark glasses, and Joe realized that she was blind. And she came in. And he developed and had a relationship with this young girl. But he figured that if she can do it, I can do it. And he came to the realization that your attitude, my attitude, is what's important. How I look at things, how I look at people. And that's the way that he looked at his patients that came into the office. God's gift to me and you is our life, folks. How we use it as our gift back to him. We can do one of three things with the life that we've been given. Number one, we can waste our lives. There are a lot of people have. When I think about that, I think about Judas in the Bible wasting his life for 30 pieces of silver. Some people have wasted their life chasing the dream, you know, money, houses, cars, those kind of things. But then there are folks that spend their life chasing that, the happiness, looking for things. Solomon's a great example of a man that spent his life, and when it was all said and done, you know, it was all vanity. It was just chasing the wind. But then we come to invest in your life. You're here today, and I'm here today because Joe Rawlings invested his life in me, and he invested his life in you. Winston Churchill said that a man makes a living by what he gets, but he makes a life by what he gives. Joe Rawlings gave unselfishly to everybody, irregardless of who you were or what you looked like want to say something to Robbie that comes directly out of the Word. In Proverbs chapter 31, we read these words. Who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. The heart of her husband safely trusts her. So he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. Strength and honor are her clothing. She shall rejoice in time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. She watches over the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is passing. But a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands and let her own works praise her in the gates. And then, guys, let me tell you what the Bible says about you. A good name is to be chosen rather than great riches. You five carry the name Rawlings. You know what that name meant here in this community. You know that you represent him now. Whatever he was, you have become. He invested his life in you guys. And all of you are very successful at what you do. In one way or another, involved in the medical field. To me, that speaks highly of your dad and the investment that he made in you. But we also read in Proverbs where it says, the righteous man walks in his integrity and his children are blessed after him. You guys have got quite a legacy. You got some big shoes to fill. You might not be able to put both of your feet in one of your daddy's shoes. But he's left you a legacy. He's left this community a legacy about loving and serving. I asked him, I said, tell me some words that describe your dad. He's humble. He's wise. He's loving. He's genuine. He's thoughtful. He's hardworking. Family is important, like Lee said. It's a celebration every time we get together. He's altruistic. I had to go look that word up, because I wasn't sure. But he has unselfish concern for the welfare of other people, and that definitely, I think, describes Dr. Rawlings. He was concerned about everybody else. Some of the things that I found out or heard, we were sitting around, we're talking, and they're throwing out different things. One thing, Joe couldn't keep a secret. He could not keep a secret. Jeff said that they could get me something for Christmas or any of, and said, you knew sooner or later he's going to hand me up. He said, I know I don't need to do this, but I just can't help it. You know, I need to tell you what I got you for your birthday, but don't tell anybody, you know. So he couldn't keep a secret. The other thing, he liked to call his boys at 4:30 or 5 o'clock in the morning when he's going to make rounds at the hospital, wake them up, get them on the phone, and as soon as he heard that voice, he'd say, excuse me, I got to go. My pager's going off. They need me at the hospital. It was just something that he did to aggravate them, I guess. I don't know. I'd never heard about this. Joe Rawlings liked to bathe with lye soap and rinse his body with vinegar. That sounds like something you do up in Tennessee. That must have been where that came from. But he had two sayings. He'd often say, I'm just as plain as an old shoe. Or he might say, I'm just an old Tennessee country boy. They went on a vacation to Amelia Island one time, and it must have been 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and somebody heard a commotion. And they get up and they go in there, and Joe's got one of these headlamps on like a coal miner, and he's sitting at the table right by himself eating cinnamon rolls. 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. I was standing in line with Dr. Karras a while ago, and I said, I've got a story that I want to tell that involves you. And he said, well, let me tell you a story. And I thought he might be fixing to tell me what I was going to share. But he said, when I first came to Thomasville, I had been here only a short period of a few days. I met Dr. Joe Rawlings. And in the course of the conversation, one of the first things he told me is, you need to go buy a cemetery plot. Dr. Karras said, I thought about that a minute, and I could interpret that in one of two ways. I'm going to need to have a short career here in Thomasville, or I'm going to have a long career. But I thought, you know, that's Joe's sense of humor. One of the most interesting stories that I heard, this family, Robbie and Joe especially, loved the movie Open Range. I don't know how many times they must have watched it over the years, but it was quite a number. One day, and George Stewart's in here, and he might can vouch for this. Joe was in Hoyt's cycle shop, and there was a gentleman in there, and I don't know how they got into the conversation, but the man had an AFib, and in the course of the conversation, he was talking about he was going to Shands. He had an appointment at Shands and a few weeks down the road to go and see about it. And Joe looked at the man and he said, well, we got heart doctors right here in town. He said, why you got to go to Shands? He said, well, if I wanted to see one of these heart doctors here in town, he said, it'd probably take me 2 months to get an appointment. Joe said, hold on just a minute. He flipped his phone out, he hit a button. Dr. Karras answers the phone apparently. In the course of the conversation, Joe turns around and says, can you be at Dr. Karras's office in 30 minutes? He'll see you. That was the way that it worked. Maybe, I know at one time that's the way medicine worked in this time. It wasn't so much about what you knew, it was who you knew sometimes that could help you. But thank you, Dr. Karras, for taking care of that. But here's the story. The man's name was Joe Moylan. I don't know if Joe Moylan was from Aspen, Colorado, but in the course of the conversation, and Joe has done this, and Dr. Karras has helped, and apparently the guy became a patient. But Joe Moylan found out that Robbie and Joe love that movie, Open Range. So it turns out he's a friend of Kevin Costner. Works in a bar in Aspen, I think, where Costner has a ranch. In their house is a picture as big as that door. And it's what you and I used to see when we go to the movies. They'd be on the outside, you know, there'd be a big poster advertising the movie. This is a poster advertising Open Range. There's not a wall in the Rawlings house that you could hang that thing on. But inscribed on it are these words, to Bo, thanks for your talent of saving lives. With respect, Kevin Costner. Kevin Costner, my understanding is, never signs an autograph. Never, ever. If I'm not mistaken, they had a chance to go later on out there and go fishing, fly fishing, trout fishing on Costner's place, all because a guy in a lawnmower shop bumps into a fella and begins a conversation with him. That was typical Joe Rawlings. But let me tell you my best story. We were sitting there that Sunday afternoon talking, and Sue and I had just gotten back from Mississippi. We'd been to a funeral. While we were in Mississippi, we were 60 miles from Memphis. And I asked Sue, I said, "You ever been to Graceland?" And she said, "No." Well, I take it back, I did when I was young. She said, "All we could do was stand out on the street and look at the house." I said, "Would you like to go to Graceland?" So we went to Graceland, took a tour, had a great time, made some memories, and came back. We're sitting there, and I don't know how the conversation got around to that. But I tell that, and Robbie looks at Joe and says, "Tell him, Joe. Tell him your story." Folks, you're not going to believe this. When Joe Rawlings was in high school, he was in a club. He was the president of that club, and one of his jobs was to get entertainment for a dance that they were going to have. So somebody in the club says, "If you'll go ask Jimmy Joe over here, he'll tell you who you need to call to get entertainment." So he goes to Jimmy Joe and asks him, and he says, "Here, I'm going to give you the number of Mr. Parker. You call Mr. Parker, and he'll be able to help you." Joe says he calls Mr. Parker. Mr. Parker tells him, "I got just the guy that you need. He's kind of new in the business, but he'll do you a really good job. He's got a band. He'll do great." And Joe said, "What's his name?" And Mr. Parker says, "Elvis Presley." And Joe thought a minute, and he said, "There is no way that I'm going to have a man named Elvis come to my school." And play at a dance that I'm responsible for. "Mr. Parker, do you have anybody else you can send?" "Joe Rawlings is the only man that I know of that ever turned Elvis Presley down." Over in 2 Timothy, we read these words. Paul's valedictory speech. This is what he had to say. "For I'm already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I've fought the good fight, I've finished the race, and I've kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing." Folks, we're in a race. We don't know where the finish line is. Nobody does. The Bible says we've all got an expiration date. Only God knows where it is. We're running this race. We're surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, people that have gone before us. Joe ran his race, and he ran it wide open. I think he loved every minute of it. I'm sure that knowing him, he never complained about his physical problems. He didn't even want anybody to feel sorry for him. But he finished. Not quite like he would have liked to, maybe, but he finished. And he's got a new home that we read about earlier. He's got a house with a lot of rooms in it. My question to you would be, if this were you, where would you be? Do you know that you know that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt? Folks, this is not home. If you're a believer, there's something better than this. Over in 1 Thessalonians, we read these words, "But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. I don't know what your relationship with the Lord is. God's word says that he demonstrated his love for us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I look in the mirror oftentimes and ask myself, is my life, the life I'm living, worth somebody dying for me? And yet he did. His word says if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God's raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. For with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. The word says God loved us so much he gave his son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Over in Revelation 3:20 it says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice, I'll open the door and I'll come in and I'll dine with you. Joe made that decision a long time ago. I'm just thankful that I know where he's at. Now it's up to me whether I see him again. That's my choice. Father, I thank you for the day, and thank you for this man and his life. Thank you for his faithfulness to honor you and to serve. Your word says that you came into this world not to be served, but to serve and give your life as a ransom for each and every one of us. Lord, I pray that the lives that we live will always be worth the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. Lord, we love you and thank you for your grace and your mercy that you extend to us each and every day. I'm thankful that Joe Rawlings in his own way glorified you, lifted you up, exalted you, served you, honored you. I pray that we'll be able to do that. And I pray, Lord, that his memory will continue on in this community, the difference he made because he chose to be different. He was a difference maker, Lord. But if he were here today, he said he gives all the credit to you. You made him the kind of man that he was, giving him godly parents and a godly mother. Lord, we just thank you for his life. Thank you for what he was able to accomplish in our community. We thank you for loving us and caring about us. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.